Last year, I went on an expedition out west to Utah to collect a variety of raw materials for future projects. This included soda ash, gold, gypsum, salt, bentonite, ochre, and even some obsidian. One of the biggest goals from this trip was to collect one element that would be crucial for an upcoming project I was challenged to last year by author Lewis Dartnell.
Next, Andy, your next challenge to level up on the series, create a primitive camera from scratch.
There are a few different silver compounds that are photoreactive, which is a crucial reaction needed for capturing an image onto film. But before I can make them, I'll need some silver. It takes millions of specialized and skilled experts around the world to produce the countless items they use every day. But could an average person do everything to make all of these items alone? Well, that's what I try to attempt. My name is Andy, and this is How to Make Everything. I was already in contact with Cody of Cody's Lab to get his assistance in making glass, and was hoping I might be able to get access to his family's mines from which he's mined and processed his own silver before. But for some reason, his family isn't too open to letting some random person from the internet go into their mine. Getting access to an active mine is pretty difficult, and had little luck with anyone I reached out to. So in my continued journey, I found myself in the southern tip of Utah at an old silver mining ghost town, Silver Reef. Utah is scattered with ghost towns all around from various mining operations that eventually dried up. Silver Reef is one of these towns, with its own unique history and unique silver ore. I met with Eric of the Silver Reef Museum to learn more about this town and hopefully get some silver ore.
So this is Silver Reef, and they found silver and sandstone here. It's one of the only places in the world that it was found in sandstone. So it took over 9 years for anybody to believe the man who first found it. He found a piece of float, which is ore that's detached from the main source. In this case, it went about 4 miles down a creek. So he took his sample to an assayer, and he refused to test it because silver and sandstone doesn't occur. Anybody knew anything about mining knew that doesn't happen. So no one would test it for over 9 years. No one would even believe him or take him serious until somebody else came here and eventually found it and promoted it. And then we had a boom town. This would have been about 1875. Over 1,000 merchants and miners came from Pioche, Nevada, and built downtown Silver Reef, which had a main street of over a mile long. More than 100 businesses were put up in 3 months. Butchers, bakers, barbers, dentists, lawyers. It was a brass band, a horse racing track. You'd get dancing lessons, singing lessons. It was a theater group here, hat makers, shoemakers, restaurants, saloons, hotels. It's undertaker, casket maker. You get my picture. Anything you wanted was here, even a photographer.
Many of the settlers in this region at this time were Mormons, but mining boom towns like Silver Reef often brought in a contrasting assortment of people.
Mormon pioneers. They didn't want to spend a lot of time on pie in the sky stuff that's going to go away. The Mormons had food and the miners had money. So it worked out for both sides in that. And if you can imagine in a desert like this where you're just scratching out everything you can to survive, and then here's this metropolis in a sense that was built in 3 months, and they had items from all over the world.
The mines of Silver Reef were mined starting in 1875, but most mining stopped just 9 years later.
Silver Reef, the mines still have silver in them, ore is still there, copper. It just got to be harder as they went deeper, and it was more about economics than the lack of ore.
Starting in 1785, the U.S. used a silver standard, which pegged the value of the currency to a fixed ratio of silver. However, the discovery of many new silver deposits in the following decades caused the silver price to be relatively unstable, and many countries, including the U.S., eventually switched over to the gold standard.
The market kind of collapsed when they went away from the silver standard.
Yeah, the gold standard was adopted by all the countries, and prices went from $1.22 an ounce to 65 cents an ounce.
Mining has resumed off and on in the area, which is still rich with silver, but at its current value, it's not worth the cost to extract it.
Down on the rivers, you'll see sand with the black specks in it. Mm-hmm. That could be silver, but it would probably take about 3 dump truck loads full of sand to get enough gas to pay for one of the trucks to get down there. So it's just not worth it.
Most recently in the 1950s, mining briefly occurred here for a different element, uranium. Like gold and copper, silver can occasionally be found as a native metal, but it's very rare. Most ore is a silver compound, usually silver sulfide, that takes a bit of a process to extract.
silver is coming out of other minerals. They're a byproduct, usually. Silver actually is an off-product of copper when they separate it. And then they would put it in the settling tanks, add this different chemistry to it, mercury being one of them, cyanide, which helps separate it from other metals like copper. They would heat that up, vaporize most of the chemistry out, and then eventually they would use the mercury as an amalgam to draw the silver to it like a magnet, and then heat the amalgam up. And then what they would have left would be the silver ore.
Desperate to get the silver I need, I ventured off to some of the abandoned mines. I definitely would not recommend exploring old mines, as there is abundance of risks involved with it, and every year people die because of it. I made sure to stick to mines which had obvious recent human activity, and only ventured in a small way.
This is a mine.
This one actually had a mattress further back. But I didn't really want to look too close at that. Plus, there was an angry bat in my way.
Is that friend?
Off to the side, I found a pile of loose rocks, and found the distinctive black line Eric had told me to look for the silver ore.
So that could be silver? All right, well, collect a little possibly silver ore here.
But I'm not a geologist or a miner, so who knows what I actually grabbed. So for some help, seeing if I even grabbed anything with even a trace of silver, I met up with someone who does know, Cody.
So I'm here with Cody from Cody's Lab.
All right, everyone.
So I collected some ore from a abandoned silver mine that may or may not have silver, might have uranium.
All right, have a look at this. Immediately I can tell this is mudstone and some sandstone pieces here. Mm-hmm. The dark sheen there is probably just manganese dioxide, although it could be uranium. Uranium does that as well. There's an easy way to tell, and that's to get a Geiger counter. Yeah, so it's not screaming, so it's probably not uranium.
Anything dangerous?
No, it's probably less than a banana. If I had to guess, and if anything contains silver, it'd be the sandstone here.
Yeah.
You can grind up some of the mudstone, some sandstone, and do like a little fire assay. And just break it into little pieces here. And then I'll finish crushing them with this. All right, there. I've got a bucket of assay flux, which is pre-mixed for doing assays. This is orange because it's got lead oxide mixed with it. At high temperatures will react to the lead oxide forming lead metal, and the lead will collect any pieces of ore, or you know, the metals that are there, into a bead, which we can more easily work with. And we'll take that out and put it into this little bone ash pot, which is really just literally bones that have been burnt to ash.
Oh, really?
So it's calcium phosphate, and this is absorbent to the lead oxide, but not lead metal.
Yeah.
And so the lead, as it oxidizes, it'll just kind of absorb in there, and we'll be left with a bead of precious metals. There we go. That's our assay charge.
So this is going to melt and basically make a glass?
Yeah, so it'll be like a really runny liquid glass.
Okay, and then the metals will...
They'll sink because they're heavy. Yeah.
Makes sense.
So there's that one.
Okay.
Judging by how much rock we're using, we'll probably wind up with a tiny, tiny bead that you'll need a lens to see. So there's those two ores. Okay. It takes a long time to crush samples by hand. So that's running. You got it set for 2000 degrees Fahrenheit. Zinc coming off. We're now up above the boiling point of zinc. The lid. There's your slag, which actually is pretty clear. Wires. Hey, that's most of it. You can see I've propped the furnace open with this other cupel there. That's just to let oxygen get in there so it can burn away the lead. Mm-hmm. Just pull this out. You see it's all oxidized away. Looks like there might be a little bit of a bead of metal down in there. So that one's actually bigger.
Oh.
Looks like, yeah. You actually probably see that on camera there. Yeah. Let's put this one down into the furnace and get it working. See it melting. Ooh. There it is. little bead of silver.
Is that considered high grade or low grade? That
you... Right on the verge of being profitable.
We succeeded in extracting a little bit of silver, just a few beads, but I did actually have silver ore.
Yeah.
And now I have actual silver. So thanks for all the help, Cody.
All right, no problem.
Thanks to Cody, I could confirm that I had managed to collect at least some low-grade silver ore, but should hopefully yield something. So back home, I repeated Cody's method of extracting it. First grinding and milling the ore. Then make my own assaying mix. Which created a lead mix which absorbed the silver and separated it from the other impurities. Then melted this on a cute ball. Which would absorb the lead and leave behind a bead of pure silver. With such low-grade ore, this could take quite a few batches. But by slowly doing larger and larger batches, I was able to collect more and more. Unfortunately, the damage caused in my obsidian experiment earlier ended up doing my kiln in. So, I'll have to switch to the propane forge to finish off the last few batches of my most concentrated silver. Get that? For this point, I'm going to collect all the different silvers I've extracted now, including the ones Cody did, and combine them together, melt it down one more time, pour it out and try and separate it, all of the slag.
No, 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 no.
Oh, God. And then I'm gonna put it inside of one more cupel to extract any of the remaining lead that might not have gotten out before. And then I should hopefully have a sizable amount of pure silver, enough to maybe make a coin. All right, so I got my silver, and it weighs about 5.541 grams. Not that valuable. Today's price, it's about $2.78, which I definitely put in more money than that to get this out. So, not the most profitable, but I have the silver. In theory, this should be mostly pure silver. I don't know its exact value though, so I'm gonna hopefully find somebody to assess it for me and give me an actual number. And my extraction method wasn't really the greatest. I could see there's a lot of potential silver still in the slag. Probably gonna try and revisit and try and extract the rest of the silver to get a little bit more of a workable amount. But for my first goal, I'm gonna attempt to make a coin out of this, and I actually have enough. Where the gold I was a little bit short on, now I have enough silver. So I'm gonna continue the evolution of money and attempt to mint my own coin using the silver.
If you enjoyed this video, be sure to subscribe and check out other content we have covering a wide variety of topics. Also, if you've enjoyed these series, consider supporting us on Patreon. We are largely a fan-funded channel and depend on the support of our viewers in order to keep our series going. Thanks for watching.